As Bill mentioned in the introduction, he mentioned that I was general legal counsel for the Continental Basketball Association. So you didn't know this until right now, but you also have an attorney speaking to you today. And I can imagine what you're thinking about now. First of all, you've got a guy who was in a plane crash. This is supposed to be a celebration here. It's a 10-year anniversary of this company. And a guy's in a plane crash. And secondly, he's an attorney. And thirdly, he works for the Denver Nuggets. What is all this about? Three strikes and you're out, right? I am not going to talk a whole lot about the Nuggets this morning, maybe just a little bit. Our team obviously is struggling right now. I'm not sure what's going to happen with this franchise in terms of its coach and management, but we'll have to see at the end of the season. We lost again last night, so we lost four in a row. But hopefully we'll get back on the winning track. We got a two-game trip coming up, Sacramento and Golden State. Hopefully we'll get back winning again. But that's aside. I want to talk about something a lot more important than, in my opinion, professional basketball, professional sports, certainly the Denver Nuggets. And that was something that happened to me that Bill mentioned that took place 11 and a half years ago, coming up on 12 this summer, and that was a life-changing event. Now, looking across this room, there's 100-plus people here, I'm sure. There are a lot of plane crashes in front of me. I know that. What I went through is not the worst thing anybody could ever go through. And like my wife says, everybody has their own plane crash at some time or another. So I know that some of you have been through tragedies. And you'll know what I'm saying when I say this. It's not so much what happens to us, it's what we do about that. And I know this morning is a time of celebration. You're celebrating 10 years of success with this company. And I don't want to bring that down by talking about a plane crash, but keep in mind, and hopefully I'll get there, I'll get from point A to point B, that this is a story of triumph for me, personally. In my mind, in my heart, I've moved from tragedy to triumph. And hopefully I'll get there by the end of the story. I'll take you through it a little bit, but remember that what happens to us is important. What we do about that, how we react to that, is more important than that. And that's what I want to share with you this morning. I want to go back to July 19, 1989, and I was working for the Continental Basketball Association back then. I was a freelance broadcaster, been doing a lot of stuff on ESPN at that time, doing a lot of college basketball. But I was hired by the commissioner of the CBA to be the deputy commissioner. That was back in the spring of 1989. The commissioner of the CBA, which is the NBA's minor league system, or was until a couple of weeks ago when the league folded, which is a whole other story, which I won't get into. Isaiah Thomas, you might remember that name, kind of brought that league down pretty quickly. But anyway, I was working as the deputy commissioner and legal counsel for the CBA, the NBA's minor league system. And I'd been on the job only 3 months. The office was here in Denver back then. And I was scheduled to fly from Denver to Chicago on July 19, 1989. In Columbus, Ohio, the next day, we're going to make a connection in Chicago, go on to Columbus, was the CBA's college draft. And I was flying with Jay Ramsdale, my boss and very good friend that morning. We got to Stapleton Airport about 6:30 in the morning for a 7 o'clock flight and found out ours was canceled. We're with United Airlines, so they put us on standby for the next 4 flights to Chicago. Standby means, of course, the flight is full, but if somebody doesn't show up, you have priority, don't check in time, you can take that seat. Finally, the 4th standby flight, it's the 5th one overall, the one we got bumped off originally, turns out to be United Flight 232 that crashes in Sioux City, Iowa. So Jay and I weren't even supposed to be on that plane. In fact, supposed to take off almost 7 hours before we actually did, and 5 flights before that. Now, I've got to tell you, over the past 11 and a half plus years, there have been an amazing number of people who have told me they were supposed to be on our flight. For some reason, they didn't get on. They changed plans, did something else. Now, if everybody was telling the truth about this, we'd have 9,000 people in this aircraft. You know the type, right? It's amazing how many people are supposed to be on our plane. My dad says it's the most overbooked flight in aviation history right there, because everybody was going on that plane.